It's my great pleasure to invite you all for the 6th EQ Solar Energy and Wind Energy, so we call this as Cleantech Finance and Investment Summit. Just beginning with a brief introduction about EQ. We started in Jan 2009, so this year end we're gonna complete 9 years as a monthly magazine in print and digital format. And we have a daily e-newspaper covering on solar energy and conferences going around every month in some major city of the of this nation. So definitely as an aim to spread awareness about solar and wind energy and renewable energies is one of the core missions, connecting people, providing a platform for people to meet, interact, for also growing the solar and the renewable energy business. Also, through our magazines, newsletters, daily updated web portals, we offer a big knowledge pool of a lot of articles, interviews, technology and product information, new policy and regulations. So it's a small introduction about us. At the beginning, I'd like to thank our event partners for partnering with us to help us organize this conference here. So if somebody would ask me, like, why are you doing all this since last 9 years? What is this really driving you? So then I would say that emergence of renewable energy, or the way this technology is getting so much promising every day, has a full potential to help us achieve energy independence. And I believe the day is not far that India and nations around the world will start celebrating Energy Independence Day. And I believe, hope for having a fourth national holiday, which will be our Energy Independence Day. So thank you very much for coming. Welcome you all. May I invite for the lamp lighting ceremony for the all the distinguished panelists and speakers of the inaugural session. First of all, our session chair, Shri Pranav Mehta ji, Chairman, National Solar Energy Federation of India. Tanya Singhal, Founder and Director, SolarArise. Mr. Onkar Kapoor from SciTech Renewable Energy. Mr. Pankaj Sehgal, Managing Director, Sun Group. And Mr. Goutam, Samanta, Head PV Technology from Orange Renewables. And Mr. Pinaki and a couple of more inaugural speakers will join us in a while. So may I invite the inaugural session members in front of the stage for the lamp lighting, please. And request everyone to welcome and open the conference with a big round of applause. Thank you very much, sir. We are deeply honored and And it is great to host everyone. May I request panelists to please take your seats on the dais? Well, somebody, I was having this interesting conversation with somebody last night, and he was like, Anand, you organize a conference every month, so how is it really? I was like, it's also like organizing a wedding every month. And he's like, is this that? No, I said, it's not just organizing a wedding, it's also to invite all the big celebrities or the superheroes of the energy industry and superheroes of tomorrow. And not just that, when we are doing in Delhi, you really need to have a lot of luck. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us this morning. May I request Mr. Pranav Mehta ji to give the inaugural speech. Thank you.
Good morning, friends, all dignitaries on the dais. I'm very happy that we are meeting today when the global capacity being added this year is of the order of 100 gigawatts. And in that, India's contribution is of the order of 5.5 gigawatts this year. And let us see what happens further. And also for some of us who started our journey when India was at 0 megawatt, 2006, to today when we are at 13,500, 600 megawatts, it is a dream come true. When we started, as you all know, the price was somewhere around 15, 16, 17 crores per megawatt, which has dropped to now 3 crores, 3.5 crores. So, as I say that, you know, as mankind, we are undergoing an evolution, energy evolution. Old inefficient ways of the grid are giving way to the new efficient ways. And also, a thing to be marked is that new entrepreneurship, new companies have entered this field and are flourishing. In fact, if we talk of just the MNRE channel partners, young MNRE channel partners, they have all come. We'll talk about the big people a little later, but all these young people that we see, they are of the age group of 25 to 40. So this, in turn, they have generated employment. So this solar movement has generated employment. It is the only sector which has generated double digit employment. So this is on the very bright side, and the price per kilowatt hour dropping is not only in India but all over the world. Having said that, we should also understand that whatever happened at that rumps, our 2.97, but we have to understand that, you know, it's not just 2.97, because it is there because of several enablers that were there, which is an ideal situation, does not exist everywhere. So when we talk of finance, we have to really understand some of those very important factors, like ease of land availability, connectivity, the client rating. For instance, they have all the client ratings, sovereign guarantee. If you take these things out, you cannot be at 2.97. So the reality is somewhere else that we should have. 2.44 is an aberration I don't even consider, as far as I am concerned. And friends, at the same time, let me mention to you that when I go to the ministry and express concern that, you know, this suicidal bids or low price bids, what is going to happen and things like that. I'll quote an important event. When Mr. Upendra Tripathi was the secretary, I went to him when the first time these prices started dropping. He only told me that, Mr. Mehta, have I ever refused if L1 was 5.5 or 6? You are talking of 5.05 or you are talking of 4.64. Your own people are doing this. So you have no case to say anything. You are a good friend, just have a cup of tea and go. Of course, then I had to explain to him that, sir, fine, I am also very happy that the price has dropped. It is your aim and our aim also as National Solar Energy Federation of India. So that we want to make solar energy affordable. But if these projects, if they come up in time, if they really come up, then it is fine. Otherwise, what will suffer? The country's solar program will suffer. And other members, other players who did not have this chance, they will suffer. So in other words, we have to make sure that those who have, my own members, those who have bid lower, they implement the project in time and in the right spirit. And one more thing before I end, because there are quite a few interesting speakers and lineup, is that, to my mind, solar has the kind of future that for finance, Dhirubhai Ambani, when I was just 24, 25 years of age, he said these words when he came up with the new idea of that convertible debentures and non-convertible debentures and partially convertible debentures. He said to his people, I remember in Mumbai one evening, he told his people that, see, this is an ocean. You take out as much as you can based on your pump capacity. So solar energy sector, to my mind, is such, and renewable energy in general, is such that it is the future, it is the ocean from which you take out as per your pump capacity. And I wish you all success in so doing. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, the first session of the day, we can have some little coffee and start ticking. Okay, perfect. So as Mr. Mehta just said, we are sitting in an ocean of solar, the ocean which is massively available for all of us. But like every year, the tariffs are dropping. So what is sustainable? Okay, so we, over the course of the day here, we will hear a lot of different points of view, which people will say on, oops, it went faster than I thought, okay, on what's sustainable. But if you look at solar, it's not just one thing that defines it. Starting from the plant design, to financing, to operations, to land, to the GHI, payment cycles, debt, module cost, whether your plant is, what AC-DC ratio you have, it's fixed tilt, it's seasonal, it's trackers, what's your cost of ROW, what's your EPC. There is a zillion factors sitting out there which defines a sustainable plant. You can't step up and say, sorry, my module pricing has come down, so my solar pricing should come up. Because it's not just one simple two variable equation. Put in one thing here and get the answer out there. We've been in this sector now from 2009, you know, for, there has been way more development in defining and deciding what makes a sustainable plant. And my friends, it is not your interest cost only. It is not your module pricing only. Those are two big factors, yes, but those are not the two only factors. We have, as an industry, matured, and not just us in India, us across globally, to have figured out that there are multiple small things that tick solar. So the time has come where we start focusing on those small things and actually get the juice out of a plant. You know, so obviously I have written down these multiple factors that you would see on the side there. And there are so many of them that I can't even, like, you know, I will spend the whole day and not even cover the tip of the iceberg. But if I would just simplify it, like simplify it really massively, I would say that it summarizes two, three key things. The first and the foremost, which is the most talked about, is the price. The price is depending on the cost. So basically the project cost. In this project cost, again, the most talked about is just the module cost. What we forget is the balance of system, the whole design on what structures you used, what technology you used, is it fixed, is it seasonal, is it tracker, what is your AC-DC ratio? What is your pitch? I know a lot of you would have heard the pitch in just cricket, but yes, pitch is a very important and like meaningful term in solar. You know, it defines a lot more on the thing. What is your development cost? How long is your transmission line? How much are you paying for ROW? You know, these are some subtle questions which really define way more to define what your actual project cost is. In addition, you would also hear a lot of the discussion happening on the debt terms. In the debt terms, interest cost is important, but that's not your biggest factor. The leverage and the tenure are two critical things that really define where we are. Early 2009 and 10 when we started, the Indian sector was typically only looking at leverages of 12, 13 years. Now, the banking sector has matured to now to look at leverages and the tenures of north of 19, 20 years, 75-80%. That's where a lot of the financial structuring is happening. A half a percent in interest rate doesn't impact as much as a two-year extra tenor. So we have to change our mindset and look beyond just those two factors. Having said that, these are the two things most commonly talked about, and I hear the maximum.
But one of the most important ones which is missed and very less talked is the actual plant design. How many times, you know, and we, for example, outsource our EPC, does the EPC player come to you and tell you that I will give you a plant at this cost and that is it? Do they talk about saying I would actually generate these many units of electricity for you? So the same plant, if it's being charged as, let's say, 100 rupees, can generate 100 units or 110 units. And the difference between them is massive. What we completely forget about is it's not just the money going in. It's the cost per unit of electricity that is getting generated. At the end of the day, it is not just the cost. It's the design and the operations. You know, O&M in solar is just 3% of the capital cost. But all returns for us developers are actually sitting in O&M. It's the time now that we stop putting the focus from saying you have to just build a plant, but you have to build a quality plant. In our opinion, it is not about 1 megawatt. It is about building the megawatt hour. I see a race these days, you know, a race to build a portfolio. Is the portfolio the worth, or is it actually the number of units you generate? How many people do I hear talking about saying that, you know, I've created these many units? I just hear more about as if these megawatts together will give you some EBITDA multiple which will change the world. Yes, that may be a short-term view, but solar is a 25, 30-year sustainable story. It's about megawatt hours. It's not just about megawatts. You know, given we are in a financial conference, I think it's good to quantify this with numbers because, like I said, wherever the numbers is where we all realize and start talking. So let's assume in a blue scale thinking, as Mr. Mehta just said, we have a 3 rupee plant, which all of us believe is sustainable. Okay, there are some base assumptions I put in here, which all of us are comfortable in and say that, okay, this 3 rupees I am okay with. And you know, it can depend on a plethora of factors like we just discussed. This 3 can be 4, it is immaterial, but this is just my starting point. Now, based on the 3 lenses that I just saw, my operations, which is how many units am I actually generating, my cost, and how much money am I actually putting in the plant, and my debt. How does this 3 rupees change? Okay, so let's look at this perspective. So let's assume you actually are able to generate 1 percentage point more. Okay, perfect. So if my plant was originally generating, say, 18% PLF, that 18% becomes 19%. You know, a lot of times we can't even quantify that because it's so small. So instead of 100 units, it's actually 100 basis point more. A 3 rupee number actually gets sustainable to give the same returns for both the debt and the equity players at a 14 paisa lower tariff. So for example, if I have a site which has better GHI to give me 1 percentage point more generation, a 3 rupee or a 3.14 rupee, or in that matter, a 2.86 rupee tariff will give me exactly the same returns. So putting a simplistic methodology to say the tariff in Gujarat, AP, MP is all the same is effectively saying that this 3 and 2.86 is the same. And for that matter, all I have done an analysis right now is on 1 percentage point. Within India, if you look at just the geographic span, this span can actually vary across 4%. That 4% directly goes to your bottom line. So the number that I'm talking about is almost a 1 rupee difference that can happen across what site you choose. And this is not just interstate. Even within intrastate, you know, you just take one specific state, you will find pockets where this difference comes up. And I think this is the most critical thing about solar, which I don't see a lot of people talking about. And I'm, you know, sometimes I'll be very honest, I get flustered as a person being in this industry since 09. You know, guys, let's move up from just talking about the cost of debt or the module pricing. Let's talk about building a correct plant, building a good plant, because the capability is here. All it needs is a little bit focus. It's not about just you know, saying that I've got a PPA, I'll put some capital cost on it, I will give it to somebody and forget about it for a year till I now need to sell the plant to someone else. And obviously, that's a very simplistic approach to life. If you want to just compare this to get a sense on why I'm saying this is important, compare this to say, our full energy is put into say, I will go negotiate with a module person on $1 cent on my pricing. I add that to say, I will further decrease the EPC cost by 5 lakhs, which is like a lot, and further decrease the O&M. I take all these three factors, I pump that in the project cost, and still all I can get back is about 10 paisa on tariff. So I will put all my energy there, but the biggest factor, which actually is the generation, which is actually the O&M, which is running the plant and creating something quality, I will completely ignore. Why? Because it's not talked about enough. Let's see the other most talked factor, which I'm pretty sure during the day we'll hear a lot, which is the interest cost, the leverage, the tenure. Again, like I said, important, but I have pumped in 3% more leverage. So from a 70 to a 73% plant, I have increased the tenure by 2 years. I have decreased the interest rate by 0.5%. All three great, good cases put together, and all I could say was 11 paisa. So the limited point I'm trying to say is, it is not one factor, it is a plethora of factors that go in there to create a sustainable factor tariff. In that sustainable tariff, we have to think about what quality of plant we are building. It is not about just megawatts, it's about megawatt hour. The project cost saving and the lower cost of capital are important, and that's where the maximum effort is put, but the generation is as important or actually more important at points of time, which is completely forgotten. So the technology designs and operations play an equally important role. It's about the units that is generated. I would love to hear people coming forward and saying, okay, you know, this is how I thought about to say the plant can give me more units. This is how the cable design should be done. This is how you actually, you know, I take a very simple factor. I don't know how many people today talk about putting the modules in a right manner. Just sorting your modules in a particular plant can give you that 1% that I talked about in generation. You know, so I don't know how many of us know this, but a solar cuts to say whatever is the minimum of a string is what your output will be. So if I have put, let's say, 5 modules of 300, 305, 310 different efficiencies, a string will limit it down to say whatever is the lowest. So say 300, that's what it'll give the output. So I'm wasting all the other modules that I've put in that string to give me the output. You know, such basic factors are available, which you just need to put your focus on and can increase your efficiency a lot, which is why I think not all plants are equal. You know, we have to see the plant on its merit, and we cannot say that now this is the sustainable tariff for the whole of India. It depends upon how you design the plant, where you design the plant, and thus, you cannot have one simple, one variable equation to say, this is the right tariff for the whole country. And like I said, it's not about the portfolio. It's about the quality plant. We as all developers, and I urge all my group friends to think about it as, you know, there's a horde of megawatts that I see everybody wants to capture. But what we should look at is the right energy that we are producing. Can we actually optimize our plants more to generate more than just saying I have a gigawatt of portfolio? So that's broadly from us. I would give you a very quick 2 minutes about us. I'm Tanya, I'm from SolarArise. At SolarArise, we do only solar. We do only grid-connected, large-scale PV projects. We don't do rooftops as well, as much. The projects can be both greenfield, or it can be acquisition. So if there's a project that is already up and running, we would be happy to acquire. Typically, we do only large-scale projects, so something north of 20, 30 megawatts. There is no limitation of the off-taker we'll work on. It can be a government party, it can be a private party, an industry, open access. But the philosophy that we follow is what I just said. We are long-term owners. We want to create the best plant which generates for the next 25 years. We are not looking to build and flip in a year. We want to generate units. We are operators. We are here to stay. So that's just broadly about us. Our investors, Kotak and EIB from Europe, are actually, they mirror exactly the same methodology that I just said. they are here to stay with us. And you would hear around me, and I'll be very happy to answer any questions. Thank you.